Hello. My name is Stephen Marlowe, and I got a story to tell. Down here in San Jose, Costa Rica, it's a long story, so get comfortable. I did a documentary a few years back about a man who lives in the jungle in the south of Costa Rica named John Howard. He built a chapel in the middle of the jungle, La Capilla en las Nubes, the chapel in the clouds. His story was unbelievable. He claims that a ghost told him to buy a piece of property in Costa Rica, so he did. He was living in England with his family, bought the piece of property, went down, stayed there, built a cabin. No idea why. He liked to build cabins, but he had no idea why the ghost told him to build a cabin or to even buy a piece of property in Costa Rica. Then he built a house. I don't know exactly which building came next, but he built a lookout tower and a library and a saloon. Built this complex in the middle of nowhere. Built some large buildings for guests to stay in, rooms. Another one. And then he was told to build a chapel. So he built a chapel. I did that movie. I can't go into it, but it's an amazing story of John going into the chapel and basically talking to God. God was giving him messages. The reason I wanted to do a movie about him and contacted him is because I got those same messages long ago and was searching for a man like John for many years. The messages continued in my life and I've gotten many. They're not pretty. They tell of a very bleak future for humanity. John's story is quite unbelievable. So I made the movie, finished the movie, and was going to release it at a festival I was planning called the Last First Festival. I pulled it off barely, just before COVID and the pandemic hit, which, by the way, is one of the predictions John made on camera in the message. You're gonna watch it for yourself. I was supposed to go back here, come back to Costa Rica after the festival and after launching three corporations, all tied together to do works for humanity, to help humanity, because we are in trouble. It's clear. Life on this planet is in trouble. And if we don't act soon, there's not gonna be a lot of hope for future generations. The documentary never got released, never made it into any festivals. I put it away because of some personal issues that arose and another story I was pursuing that I can't discuss right now. Out of the blue, I decided to contact an old friend from my journalism days, just to see how she was doing. We hadn't spoken in decades, and then I basically had wiped myself off of social media, wanted nothing to do with it anymore, and was just reaching out to friends, people I hadn't spoken to in a long time. and her sister and I had a little tryst back in the day, and I always thought about her. I always wondered about her, and how she was doing, and I kind of used her sister in a way. I checked in with her, but I really wanted to know about Clara. So after the niceties and that, I got onto the issue of Clara and asked for her number, and Clara and I connected and started, you know, to enjoy each other's company. One day we were walking around the Patterson Falls. Her family was originally from Patterson, and when I knew her back then, this is, 20 years ago, that's where her family was from. So we were walking around this huge area, and just out of the blue, Clara just goes, "Oh my God, Sister Teresa," and starts running. She's running full bore, and I just kind of went after her and was like, okay, I guess this is an important person in Clara's life, and she wanted to say hello. And lo and behold, Sister Teresa was with an entourage of people, all connected to a Catholic nun. Sister Teresa is a Catholic nun, by the way, with the Salesian Order of Don Bosco. Clara's whole family, four sisters, I believe, all attended school there. I'll have to get the name. I think it's Holy Family, but it's under the Salesian Order of Don Bosco in northern New Jersey. So they started talking, and they introduced this person and that person, and they start talking about this one particular nun named Sor Maria. Sor Maria Romero Mensis. You know, I was just kind of, oh, well, that's interesting. And she's telling the story and telling, you know, this person knew her, and you should really, you know, find out about her story. She was something special. And the more I listened, the more I got interested, and the more I said, I want to tell this woman's story. So I asked, has anyone done anything? And they said, no. She is amazing. I say is because I feel her presence, and when I tell you this story, I still don't believe it. She is here, she is guiding me, and she is, I can't even talk about it sometimes. Sor Maria was put on the path to sainthood by John Paul II, the first saint from Central America. A woman born in Nicaragua to a wealthy family. She was always a very giving person and found herself drawn to the Salesian Order, and she became a nun. She was sent to northern New Jersey, where she met the nuns in northern New Jersey, including Sister Teresa, and she stayed there for a certain amount of time, I'm not sure. But after that, she was sent to Costa Rica. And in Costa Rica, this was probably the 30s or 40s. Now, she was born in like 26, I want to say. So it would probably be about 20 or 30 years after that, maybe the 50s, probably 50s. I have to get all these dates correct and everything. There's a lot of research I still have to do with this one. But when she came to Costa Rica, she began building. And she built a shelter for abused women. She built schools for children. She built a hospital. I believe it was a children's hospital. She built this entire network to help the poor, the impoverished, the infirmed in Costa Rica, in the capital, San Jose. I really don't know much of the history of San Jose back then, but I can't imagine it was a very pleasant place to be. I don't know. I really don't know. I first came to Costa Rica in 2000 on my honeymoon. Brief marriage to a beautiful woman who still friends to this day and I love dearly. But that was my first adventure here, and I've come back numerous times between friends, bachelor parties, and just vacations, and I fell in love with the country over time. But there was an underbelly that I really was not, I didn't like. Prostitution is legal here, and children are sold for sex on a regular basis, mostly to Americans, American sex tourists from around the world, for sure, but a lot of Americans. And over time, I began to see the changes in the tourist areas of Costa Rica. What was once, you know, a beautiful paradise, I saw in the beginning, you know, back in 2000, you know, this is not right. And it got worse and worse and worse. And they literally destroyed paradise for the sake of tourism. Jaco, one city in particular, is just a pit of evil. It's just evil. The beautiful Manuel Antonio is overrun with tourist buses and hotels and restaurants and catering to money coming from all around the world. So of course there's crime, there's pickpocketing and muggings, and you know, now it's getting worse with murders, and you can just imagine where there's money and there's greed, there's always crime. So when I told Sister Teresa that I wanted to do a documentary, she gave me her phone number, and we were in touch for a little while. I also got the number of one of her entourage, a woman, I can't remember her name, but I tried to contact her. I did contact her, actually, and she put me in touch with another woman from Miami called Olga Arguello, who was kind enough to do a brief hour-long interview on Zoom during the pandemic. Couldn't travel at that time, it was in lockdown, but she did tell me the story, and hopefully one day I'll be able to get her permission to use it. but they stopped answering my inquiries. I have a long, sordid history with the Catholic Church. I don't want to get into it, but it was very public. I was very public about it, and I'm sure that's why they were probably ordered or told not to correspond with me anymore or allow me to make a documentary about Sor Maria. And I wish I had the opportunity to explain to them that, you know, despite my rants and dislike of the Catholic Church and some of the leaders and some of the things that they've done, I don't blame all Catholics or all people within the Catholic Church. I don't believe in religion. I believe in messages. I believe in those who get messages from the universal spirit. People call it God, people call it spirit, the universe, whatever you want. To me, it's just energy, and it's universal. So I ranted pretty hard, and I know that they are afraid of what I'm going to report, and that wasn't my intent. The more I learned about Sor Maria, the more I wanted to tell her story. She is a fabulous woman. She did phenomenal work down here in Costa Rica and built networks of organizations that do such good for the people of Costa Rica. And boy, do they need it now more than ever. I stopped pursuing the chance of a documentary when they didn't respond, because without the Catholic Church's help or permission, what am I going to tell? Who am I going to interview? I can't talk to anybody about her. So I'd have to, you know, go around them, and you don't go around the Catholic Church. You can't tell a story about a Catholic saint without the involvement of the Catholic Church. But it kept gnawing at me, and I kept getting this feeling, this energy coming to me. Go after it, pull it out. Something would come up and I would talk to somebody about her and how much I wanted to do the story, and I still just no, not yet, not yet, not yet. Turns out I wasn't ready. I was running from my past, running from some things that I really just struggled to understand about Costa Rican life and how they allow their children to be sold like they do. I just don't understand it. And I ran away. Drugs and alcohol, depression, suicidal thoughts. I just locked myself away and wanted nothing to do with most of the world. Give up, basically. I was ready to basically go off to the north, to my home in Canada, and just retire, just go. But something kept gnawing at me, and gnawing at me, and gnawing at me. And then I got sober. And I started to think clearly and rationally for the first time in a long while. And I saw it. I saw what I had to do, or at least I thought. I knew I had to go to Costa Rica. I had purchased a ticket in November of 2021 because I wanted to go and interview Olga down in Miami, and then go to Costa Rica to visit this network that Sor Maria built to get to know her. Still didn't have permission of the Catholic Church, but I was just gonna knock on the door and see what happened. Also got a chance to see Tool in Miami, which was a lot of fun, but I never heard from Olga, so I never got to interview her. I saw Miami and South Beach and was pretty disgusted at what they did. Very similar to what I saw in Manuel Antonio. Paradise just turned into a haven for greed and disgusting behavior. I came to San Jose from there and had lots of issues with the bank, not able to get money. I wasn't eating because I didn't have money. I should have exchanged money before I came. Stupid me, stupid Americano. But I didn't. So I just focused on the goal, which was to get to know Sor Maria. And I got to know the neighborhood a little bit. I wandered around a little bit. And then I just went. Hungry, penniless, well, $10 in my pocket. I went to her chapel and I saw the school and I saw the shelter and I saw this huge building after building, all surrounded by bars and barbed wire and prison-like. I saw homeless people everywhere. I saw empty buildings, and I saw torn down buildings that looked like they were in a war. And I felt so sad for these people, because there would be a homeless person or someone begging for money, and they were invisible to most of the people that walked by with their cell phones and fancy clothes and supercars and off to their fancy lunches and back to work. But when I got to the chapel, I could just feel this energy. And it was closed, so I was walking across the street and taking pictures, and this little nun came out of a door, and I asked her what time, you know, is that Casa de la Virgen, the Virgin, House of the Virgin, Virgin Mary it's referring to, I believe. She said yes, and they opened at 1. So I just walked down the street a little bit, and in one corner there's this huge statue of Mary with baby Jesus on the corner of the building. It just kind of touched me, so I genuflected. I'm not a religious guy anymore. I don't go to church, and I don't do that. But I just genuflected and blessed myself and said, help. You want me to tell the story? You got me here. I don't know why I'm here. So help me. Help me understand why I was drawn here and why you want me to be here. And what do you want me to do? What story do you want me to tell? Or I don't know. I didn't know. And I'm still not sure. But I wound up going to a little deli. It's like a quickie mart, I guess you'd compare it to a 7-Eleven or a Quick Check back in the States. And I had my ATM card, which was not giving me cash, and I couldn't get any money at the bank, but I asked the gentleman behind the counter if he would try to see if it would work so I could just get some food, something to eat. I was starving, and I was so tired from walking and walking and walking. Still jet lagged. And it worked on the third try. I don't know why, but it was the third try. So I was able to get a little snack and a little sandwich and some food, and I felt a lot better. And I was thinking of going home and just collapsing because I was so tired and ready for a nap. But I said, no, let's go up to the chapel. Let's go up there. And I went in, just the security guard at the door, probably not more than 19 or 20 years old. And he wasn't gonna let me in. He's like, oh, no. I'm like, can I just walk around and just say a little prayer? And he's like, okay, come on in. So as soon as I breached that doorway and got past his vision, I just felt it just rush. This energy, this wave, this overwhelming feeling of sadness and anger, and there was a joy in it as well, I think, that I didn't feel till later on, but it felt like she was glad that I was there. She was happy that I was there and was sending me joy. At the same time, I felt this incredible sadness, and I just burst into tears. I was not even 10 feet in the building. I saw a picture of her in the back, and I saw what looked like an altar and maybe a coffin or where her body is laid to rest. I don't know. I was just drawn to it in this wonderful, like, monument area that's kind of outdoors, and there's these concrete benches, and I cried the entire way there, and I had trouble walking, and I just knelt and cried and wept. I'm trying not to do it now. And nobody else was there besides this one older woman. I don't know where she went, but I was alone. I couldn't believe it. this woman is the first Catholic saint from Central America. And no one has told her story. No one knows who she is. Apparently Costa Ricans revere her, but there was nobody else there but me. I managed to stand up at one point and I went behind the altar and kind of read it, and it said something that I can't recall, mostly her birth, where she was born and where she was laid to rest. There was a picture of her on the side where you could put in donations, and I didn't have any money to give a donation. But I cried, and I cried, and I walked around, and then finally I went into the chapel and went straight to another gigantic photo or painting of her. Got on my hands and knees again, and I begged her, "Why am I here? What is it you want me to do? Why did you bring me here? I need help." I've been saying that for the last couple weeks, just putting it out there, like, all right, you want me to go, I'm gonna go, I'm going, so why? Help me, please. Nothing. All I could feel was sadness. Sadness. Overwhelming, just joy. Was there, and that maybe there was hope that I could discover why, and I could achieve whatever goal she has in mind for me or wanted me to see or do. It's hard to know. It's really hard to understand. I walked around a little bit more and tried to shake it off, but the tears were just coming and I was choking up and trying to hide from the security guard, and I heard a door open at one point and just turn the other way because I just didn't want anyone to see me crying. And I got out the back of the chapel and there was this picture of Sor Maria with some children, a painting, just a beautiful painting. Just a wonderful representation of what I felt this woman was. She loved children, and she did so much for children and for women. And I cried again, and I just could not stop. And I said, I had to leave. I just had to go. I couldn't stay there anymore. I didn't know what to do. So I just hightailed it past the security guard saying thank you as the tears are coming down and I'm just choking up. I made a right-hand turn, went this way, went that way, lit myself a cigarette because I'm a smoker and it helps me calm down. And I called my therapist, Jack. I didn't know what else to do, who else to call, who would be able to handle this. Jack was a former Catholic priest who got me through the most suicidal times in my life and saved my life on numerous occasions. So I instantly felt Jack. And I got his voicemail and he called back, but I didn't hear it for some reason. So I called him back and we got disconnected, and then he called me back, and it took a couple times, but we finally got through. I explained to him the story and he got me through it. He got me to calm down, and he's good at, you know, getting me to focus. And he just said, let it out. Whatever it is, whatever feelings you're getting, don't hold back. Let it out. So I did. And I did. And thank you, Jack. Thank you, Sor Maria. I know my mom and dad are here, and they're definitely been a major guidance in my life and a really part of the reason I'm here. A big part of the reason I'm here. Made it back to my apartment, did some work, and managed to tell the story to Clara. She's been a big part of this story ever since. I'm trying to relaunch my nonprofit, my charitable organization, and a festival idea that I had called the Last First Fest. The company is going to be called the Last First, taken from the Bible and the verse of the last shall be first. Art and music for charity, with the goal of helping humanity to help itself and steward life on this planet like humans should have done from the start. We're supposedly the most intelligent beings here, at least that we know of, and we're just so stupid. We don't even think sometimes about the destruction we cause and the evil that just pervades this place. So I was working on that and back and forth with Clara on some things, told her the story and almost broke into tears again. And then I went to dinner. I was still exhausted, still hadn't slept, but I just kept getting this energy, and I ate and I was ready to go, and then I got tired again and I was ready to go to sleep, but I said, it's almost 9 o'clock at this point. You can't go to sleep now. You gotta stay awake. So go for a walk. I like going for walks, and especially at night, because that's when the freaks come out and you get to see what's really going on in the city. During the day, it's just the hustle and bustle and people working. But at night, that's where you see things. Something said, go that way, away from Sor Maria on Highway 2, and go up the hill. So I went up the hill, and I stumbled across this huge, beautiful church. I have to find out the name. Clara knows it, and I can't remember it, but I thought what might have been the cathedral, Metropolitana, which is the main church for the Catholics here in Costa Rica and San Jose, but it wasn't. It was something else. Holy Family, Holy Angels, I don't know, but it's beautiful, just beautiful, lit up. And then there's this statue of Jesus, dark and brown, sitting on the lawn, surrounded by this huge steel gate and barbed wire. I walked around to the front and the steps, and I'm seeing all this trash everywhere, just trash. And there's somebody sleeping, a homeless person in a blanket sleeping, and there's another and another. And then there's a guy who's awake and, hey, you got any money? And of course they always ask for money and want to tell you their story, but I didn't have any cash. So I gave him a cigarette and I asked him, "Is what's going on with this church here? Why is there so much trash?" And he says, "Oh, Cerrato, it's closed. They don't do services anymore. They haven't done them for years. But it's still lit up and it still looks beautiful because it's on one of the main highways in downtown, across from a beautiful park and this hospital network that I believe was started by Sor Maria." I just got sad again, and it kind of made sense. Seeing all the poverty, all the homeless, all those who need the hospital, the lines were just incredible. There's a children's wing that was filled with people in the waiting room. And this man shows me his hand, and he says he can't afford to get help. I thought Costa Rica had one of the most amazing, you know, medical systems in the world, and everyone can get care, but no, you gotta pay. And he can't afford to fix his hand, and it's all blown up and swollen. He can barely move the fingers, but he can smoke that cigarette. And I just had to get away, so I went over to the park and I called Clara. And I asked her to look up the name of the church, and I told her the story and how sad I was and how it kind of made sense now, the story I'm supposed to tell and why I'm here. Saw Maria, and I think a lot of others who are on the other side are pretty angry and sad at what is happening here in Costa Rica. They've destroyed paradise and focused so much of the government's resources to the tourist sections along the beach or the volcano or the rainforests, because tourism is 8% of the economy here. But the city, the capital, is a mess. There are buildings for sale everywhere and empty lots. And you have this amazing, you know, structures dedicated to helping battered women and children that are just in disrepair, and they look so in need on the outside. And then on another corner, opposite them, is one of the most grand hotels that is the monument to opulence. It's just this contrast between poverty and rich that I just could not even, you can't make it up. When you see it, you're gonna freak. I did. And it's like that everywhere. Poverty next to elitism and the rich. Huge buildings and towers of money next to these little hovels where people are barely living and surviving. Super fancy restaurants and then little tiny taquerias that serve the rest of us. It's so fucking sad. I walked across the park, across from this church, and there were homeless there, and clearly a drug addict there, and what I believe was a pimp and two prostitutes waving at me, hey, puppy, kind of thing. And in the other corner was a discotheque where people were partying and drinking, loud music going on, and it was just the antithesis of what I expected from this country. They talk so much about God and Jesus and their devotion, but they can't even keep one of the most beautiful churches I've ever seen filled with people. They can't get enough people to keep it open. They had to close it. I finally Googled the Cathedral Metropolitano, and it was up the hill a little further on top. So I said, okay, I'm this far, I'm going. And I went, and wow. Just huge building after huge building of marble and stone and pillars. And there's this what I thought was a fucking bank. The last thing I would think of would be cathedral or church. It literally looks like a fucking bank. Bars, of course, nobody can get in, nobody can steal our gold and robes and... Yeah, again, another park, beautiful little park, lots of cool monuments, but same corner over on the other side, this one alley goes through and there's a bigger discotheque with multiple floors and a DJ on top. You can see the lights flashing, and then the bottom floor is filled with people just staring out, drinking at, you know, everyone passing by. And then there's a lower floor where it looks like a restaurant. And then the ground floor is, you know, where you enter and you can buy, you know, all different kind of food and things. But the alleyway, just these tiny little shops all closed up because it was late by then. You know, a prostitute here, what looked like a gang member there. People coming look like they're heading home from work late at night or from the hospital. And homeless, so many homeless. In the park, in the alleys, on the church benches. I go around back of this cathedral. And it's this gigantic wall. Looks like a fucking bank. But more like a prison, in a sense, because there's no windows. It's just straight concrete with nice carvings and pillars, but kind of the shape where a window would be, but I don't think there were ever any windows. So I just walked on by. Disgusted. And I knew. I'm not exactly sure why, but I knew. I'm here for a reason. And you're damn right, I'm gonna fucking figure it out. I'm coming. You better watch. Fucking run.